Welcome to the Real Estate Way to Wealth and Freedom podcast with Jacob Ayers, providing actionable content to help you along your journey to financial freedom through real estate investing. As the premier asset class, real estate has helped ordinary people just like you amass fortunes. The benefits of passive income from real estate investing will allow you to live a life you want. And now your host, entrepreneur, real estate investor, and apartment deal syndicator, Jacob Ayers.
Hi, and welcome to the Real Estate Way to Wealth and Freedom podcast, episode 77. I'm your host, Jacob Ayers. Thanks so much for tuning in to yet another episode. This week, our guest is Mark Ferguson. Mark's purpose is to help as many people as he can become financially free through real estate investing. Mark is a real estate agent, investor, author, and creator of InvestFourMore.com. Mark's real estate team sells hundreds of homes a year, and he has flipped over 100 houses and owns 16 rental properties and has written 5 books. InvestFourMore.com is a real estate blog with over 300,000 views a month and over 35,000 subscribers and a wealth of free information. Mark historically averages over $30,000 profit on each flip he completes and over $8,000 a month income from his rental properties. These returns and profits do not come from a secret, unknown, get-rich-quick scheme. They come from knowing the fundamentals, knowing them better than anyone else, and execution. Mark has created coaching programs for real estate investors and real estate agents to show them how to make solid investments that will pay off over time. Mark also loves to teach business and time management, and he is a proud father of 5-year-old twins. With 4 extremely successful businesses, Mark only works about 40 hours a week. He says he would work less, but he just loves what he does. Now, without further ado, let's jump into today's episode. All right, today I welcome on the show Mark Ferguson. Mark, thanks so much for joining us.
Oh, happy to be on the show, and I'm excited to get going here.
Hey, thanks so much, Mark. Well, Mark, can you tell the audience a little bit about yourself and what drew you to investing in real estate?
I grew up in a real estate family. My dad became an agent in 1978, and I wanted nothing to do with it all through high school. I went to college for a business finance degree, and when I graduated, I couldn't really find an awesome job that paid me as much money as I wanted, so I thought I'll just work part-time in real estate till I figure it out. And got my license, started working with my dad, realized how nice it was to have the freedom, kind of the ability to be your own boss in real estate, and I got hooked. Focused on selling houses mostly, but he'd occasionally flip a house too. So I learned that business. And then eventually things, you know, exploded for me as becoming an REO and HUD agent, started buying rentals, took over the business from him, started flipping more and more houses, started a blog, and just kind of things spiraled from there.
Yeah, awesome. Well, sounds like you kind of got in the business out of almost a little resentment to begin with and turned into actually doing pretty well with it. So what was it that you got started in first, Mark? Was it flipping or buying holds?
I had flipped with my dad since 2002. So we would usually flip a few houses a year in the beginning. Then we got that a little bigger. And then I really focused on being an agent for a few years in the mid-2000s, selling HUD homes, foreclosures for banks. And I started making a good amount of money with that. And I thought, I need a good way to invest this money because I didn't see my stock market investments, other things growing like I thought they should be. And so I did a ton of research on franchises, businesses, real estate, stock markets, anything I could think of. And it just kept coming back to rental properties being the best investment. So 2010, I bought my first rental, ended up buying 16 in the next 5 years, took a little break, and then I bought 4 more this year. And I kind of think of the real estate agent business, the flipping business as a job, ways to earn income. And really the investment side of it is buying rentals, growing cash flow, growing net worth. And it's been a ton of fun.
Yeah, that's no doubt. Flipping certainly is a business. Some people consider flipping to be investing, but really it's a day job unless you turn it into a business and outsource it and remove yourself from that business. But at the end of the day, it is still it's a job, right? So
yep, exactly. And I have a pretty big operation going now. I think I'm going to end up flipping 27 houses this year. So I do have a project manager, assistant who does all our contracts. I don't do any of the work myself, that's for sure, as far as manual labor. So I've tried to turn it into a business, but I still finding deals. And that's really what I find myself doing most, is just finding those really good deals and trying to manage things.
Yeah, Mark, well, let's drill into that business, if you don't mind, a little bit. So what's that flipping business look like for you today, and how did you grow it? I mean, I guess it probably got started by your ability to find deals being, you know, an agent. So could you talk about that process?
Yeah, I ended up buying out my dad in 2013. We'd flipped maybe 6 houses, was the most we flipped in a year before that. And he was much more conservative than me for what he would buy, deals he'd look at. And I wanted more control of the team and that side of it. So I really just started kind of focusing on getting better financing. So finding more lenders, finding more deals. We used to buy almost all of our properties from foreclosure sales, local public trustee auctions. And I started buying from the MLS, wholesalers, doing my own direct marketing, just expanded how I got deals. And in the beginning, you know, I was buying a lot of rentals. So I kind of do quite a few flips, but also trying to buy rentals. Our market got really crazy with home prices here in Colorado. So I stopped buying as many rentals and just kind of funneled pretty much all the money I could back into the flipping business, and went from, I think I sold 8 in 1 year to 12 to 18. And then, like I said, this year we'll sell 27. And it's just been reinvesting that money into it, really finding a steady flow of deals, like I said, from a number of different sources, financing them with local banks, some hard money lenders, a lot of private money, my own money, making sure the processes for repairing them with contractors, I have my own employees now who work on them, is really in line. Because that's the biggest challenge, is finding enough people to work on them.
Yeah, yeah, great. Well, Mark, you mentioned doing this out of the need for wanting freedom. So, you know, you've probably got a little bit of freedom with your flipping business now, but I'm sure getting it up off the ground when you were flipping those 6-8 houses a year, I'm sure it was a lot of work. So what has drawn you to kind of investing in your buy and holds out of the desire for achieving this freedom?
I have a lot of different goals in life. When I first got into the REO business and making a lot of money, before that point, I did okay, but not spectacular. And I kind of got into the, I'd say, mindset of, I don't have to have expensive things or nice things. I'm happy with the way life is, even though I'd been a car nut since I was a kid. And when I started making more money, it started popping into the back of my head that, well, maybe I could do a little better than I have been, or maybe I should expand my goals. And I really started working on myself more, setting goals, you know, not limiting myself and my beliefs based on what society told me I should do or what my financial wallet said I should do. And when I started setting those big goals and really trying to expand the way I thought about life and myself, success just came more and more. And what really attracted me to rentals along those lines was cash flow. You know, once you buy one rental property, it pretty much will perform for you for the rest of your life if you hold on to it and buy it the right way. And so it's just a matter of accumulating, you know, $500, $1,000, I think up to about $8,500 a month in cash flow right now from my rentals with property managers. You know, I don't do any work on them. So that's really been my goal, is to just keep building up that cash flow that comes in every month, that passive income. And then, you know, it's kind of lets me be more aggressive with the flipping and other things, because I know I have that cash flow to fall back on if something happens.
Yeah, awesome. And it's so important to investors out there, focusing on that cash flow, because that really is what your freedom is derived from.
Exactly. You know, I like the freedom number, where, you know, you try and cover all your expenses with your cash flow. And once you get to that point, you can kind of do whatever you want. I love business. I love working. But, you know, I also love my family and vacations and time off. And it's a really a great business for all of that.
Yeah, right. Well, Mark, it sounds like once you started setting bigger goals and kind of breaking those societal norms of, you know, achieving more than you were currently doing, is kind of when you started to turn that corner and really start doing much larger deals.
For sure. You don't realize how much you limit yourself until you kind of break through some of those hurdles. Like, you know, I'm a huge fan of exotic cars, as you know, you're on my website a little bit. And I always loved Lamborghinis as a kid. Kind of when I got into my early 20s, that dream kind of faded away, because I didn't think I'd ever could achieve that. And then it slowly crept back. And so that was one goal for me, was to buy a Lamborghini, which, you know, a lot of people say it's egotistical, whatever, but it really helped me business-wise focus and motivate me. And one point that was really a turning point, I went to a conference in Dallas for real estate, and I took a little break from the conference and went to Lamborghini of Dallas, and they had a Diablo there. I'm like, oh, you know, such a beautiful car in person. And I looked at it and talked to the dealers, and they're like, you know, you can finance these, right? I'm like, well, yeah, with a car loan. I'm like, no, you can get a 12-year, it's like a mortgage on an exotic car.
No way.
and your payment's like $1,200 a month. I'm like, what? Yeah, like 5% interest, 15% down. I'm like, kind of a, I felt myself get nervous and like, oh my God, I could actually buy this. And then all these feelings came in like, oh God, I shouldn't buy this car. I don't deserve this. What's going on?
Yeah,
and
I realized, yeah.
Like, oh wow, it's a lot closer than I thought it was. And I ended up buying it the next year and just been a fantastic experience.
Yeah, well, Mark, it's kind of interesting. I mean, you say, yeah, people might think it's egotistical or a bad investment or a not investment at all. But to you, it's almost helped you with your personal development, setting larger goals and kind of rewarding yourself for your hard work. Talk about what that kind of meant to you and what it's doing for you now.
Yeah, I mean, just the first time I saw that car, because I bought this car, I'm in Colorado. The car was at a dealer in Seattle. So it was $126,000. I debated back and forth whether I should get it. It's a really beautiful Monterey blue, which is an extremely rare color. And I thought, okay, I have to get this car. Probably never going to find one like this again. So I ended up buying it. The first time I saw the car was when it arrived in the truck on Father's Day in 2014. And the first time I drove it was that day too. And it was just a mind-blowing experience. I mean, I was just ecstatic for weeks on end. But there's a lot of things that happened with it that I didn't expect too. You know, people didn't think bad of me. I'm sure some people did, but a lot of people just loved it. They want to talk to you. They want to see it. And you can kind of share that experience with people and kids. And then the networking it has provided has been amazing. I've met so many different car people in the area through clubs, through car shows who are high net worth individuals, really interesting people. And it's kind of like that was an entry into really expanding my network and meeting like-minded people as well. So that was really cool. And then it's helped out my website. It's just been a ton of fun. And it's also doubled in value since I bought it. So that hasn't hurt either.
Yeah, yeah, that's really fun, Mark. And it's awesome to see that what happens when you expand your mindset and set bigger goals, what is really in reality achievable.
Yes, exactly. And, you know, 7-8 years ago, I would have never thought I would have had that car when I was 60, you know, let alone now when I'm, what, 38, I think. So
yeah,
it's pretty awesome.
Awesome. Well, Mark, let's switch gears a little bit and get back to real estate investing. We could talk cars all day, but, but well, maybe you could. I can't as well. But so anyways, Mark, what are some of your current projects looking like now? And, you know, what's your business looking like in terms of your buy and holds versus your flips?
Yeah. So like I said, I stopped buying in 2015. Up to that point, I always bought single family residential rentals. They performed really well. I could get really good deals on them. And then our median price where I'm at went from about $110,000 in 2011 to right now it's at $290,000. So our prices have almost tripled. And along with that, rents went up maybe 50%. So you just could not cash flow anymore with the rental properties. And I found myself buying worse and worse deals. And I just thought, okay, I shouldn't be buying houses just to buy them. I need to make sure they're good investments. So I took a little break. I thought about buying out of state, looked at all kinds of options. And what I ended up doing this year was actually buying commercial rentals. So I've bought 4 straight commercial properties. That's been really fun learning that side of the business. They cash flow really well. They're very complicated. It's very, you know, figuring out value, cap rates, leases, tenant improvements, all that is very new to me, which is exciting too. But it's just opened up my eyes to a whole nother business. So yeah, I bought 4 rentals this year. They're commercial, still flipping the residential houses because, you know, I can still get good profits on the flips, even though they don't cash flow as a rental. So I'm still sticking with that same formula for rentals, the flips. And then one really big project I'm working on right now, I actually have a multi-million-dollar commercial property under contract that's set to close the start of the year. So that's a really exciting one. It's kind of a grocery store, coffee shop, restaurant with some vacant space as well, where you can add value. It's cash flowing right now. And that's a really exciting project I'm working on.
Yeah, really cool. What kind of led you into the commercial space, Mark? Was it just purely the cash flow or the kind of economics in your local market? Was that it? Or was it some kind of demographic or need that you saw in the commercial space?
It was kind of a need that blossomed into my current investing. So I wanted to buy a small shop space for materials, maybe for some cars, because I ran out of space at my house. And there was almost no space available for just small 1,500 to 3,000 square foot shop space. It's all rented, nothing for sale. And I started talking to commercial agents about this, like, oh yeah, there's been demand for this forever. There just isn't anything being built. There's nothing available. So I wanted to buy kind of a big warehouse or something like that, split it up into small spaces and rent that out. That was my original goal. And I actually had another really big project to do that fell apart for a number of reasons. But from that brought me into the commercial world. And eventually I found, oh, there's some smaller shop type spaces like that that kind of fell into my lap that I ended up buying. And then just started looking at other opportunities with the cash flow, the economics of it all. And it just ballooned into getting more and more in depth into the commercial world. And it's just kind of a step-by-step process that drew me into it.
Yeah, awesome. Okay. Well, that makes sense. And, you know, a lot of people have their property types that they're kind of like, you know, niche down into. And some people are afraid of commercial. Other people don't touch single family homes. So just kind of interesting to get your perspective on how you made that transition and why.
Yeah. And I've always loved single family homes, but you know, a lot of people always ask me, why don't you move to multifamily properties? And I have nothing against multifamily. I think they can be great, but they're, in my opinion, overpriced in our market as well, with really low cap rates, very little opportunity. So it was just kind of adapt to your market and where you can make money in it. And sometimes single family doesn't work. Sometimes multifamily doesn't work. Sometimes commercial doesn't work, but usually there's at least something in there that you can find that'll cash flow for
yeah,
you.
Yeah, that's the beauty of real estate. There's so many ways to do it and so many ways to make money. You've just got to find the one that appeals to you and go with it.
Exactly.
Well, Mark, can you tell us a little bit about some of your best and worst deals you've ever had? I'm sure flipping as many houses as you've had, you've come across some awesome deals and some not so great deals. So could you kind of share some of those highs and lows with us?
Yes. The worst one was 10 years ago now. And I was working with my father, wanted to make more money. So I thought it would be a really good idea if I started doing manual labor on the houses to earn extra money. So I was painting some properties, doing some other stuff. And I thought, I'm going to buy my own flip and just do all of it myself. And so I ended up buying this older property from, you know, like the 1920s. And I went in there and I replaced the kitchen, replaced the doors, replaced the windows, did flooring, did paint, took out a wall, just ruined my life, basically. It took me like 6 months to complete all this work. I didn't really know what I was doing, so I wasn't a licensed contractor, so it wasn't the best work either. And in the end, I saved no money because a contractor could have done it so much faster. The work wasn't done as well because I wasn't a professional. And I lost so many opportunities because I wasn't selling houses as an agent. I wasn't finding new properties to flip. And it was my worst year by far in my career. And I ended up losing money on that house to top it all off because our market started declining. So it was a really bad deal, but it also taught me a lot at the same time. It taught me I don't need to do the work myself. I have much more valuable things I can be doing. I need to be a manager, not manual laborer. And so it taught me that, and it really helped me work in my business from that point forward. So that was my worst one, but also taught me a lot. So it was good in a way. And then my best one was a crazy high-end flip I did where there was a tenant in the house who had this kind of bogus 10-year lease they'd made up to avoid foreclosure. It was just a crazy situation. So nobody else wanted to touch it with a 10-foot pole. I ended up getting a really good deal on it. I'm like, I'm going to take this chance. We're going to try and get this tenant out. And I think I bought that house for $535,000. Usually I'm buying houses in the $100,000 to $200,000 range. So it's way out of my comfort zone. Negotiate with the tenant forever. It was, her husband was in prison for securities fraud. It was crazy, but we paid her like 20 grand to leave. We got her out. House was in decent shape. And I think we ended up selling it for $804,000. And the profit on that was somewhere around $150,000 after holding it for like 16 months because she's renting it for a while. But everyone told me, don't do it. Don't buy a house. And it worked out really well, but it was stressful at the same time. But we learned a lot on that one too.
Yeah, awesome. Well, it sounds like you quickly realized to try to effectively use your time to its best and highest use by not going in and swinging a hammer and being a handyman or a construction foreman on the job. It's probably not your best use of time, you realized, but rather working on your business and, you know, not in the weeds of doing all the manual labor. So yeah, really good stuff.
Yep. We joke now when I do anything like pull up some carpet to look under the hardwood, it's like, oh, there's my manual labor for this job.
Yeah, put enough in. That's yep. That's all. Well, Mark, how have you built your team up to this point? I'm sure you've got a lot of crew members with, or contractors rather, working on your flips. What other team members have you built around you to help, you know, contribute to your success?
Yeah. When I was doing the REO and HUD stuff, I got to a point where I sold 200 houses a year and I was working 12-hour days going nonstop. And I realized I just could not keep that up with my family health-wise and stress-wise. So I hired kind of a personal assistant, Nikki, who started out part-time, kind of taught her some tasks I hated doing. I'm like, here you go. I'm going to teach you how to do these, make my life easier. She ended up being full-time, started giving her more and more responsibilities. And I just realized how nice it was having that help and things got done better. I know a lot of people are afraid to let go and let other people do tasks, but I was so busy and trying to do so many things at once. I was letting things slide. I wasn't getting anything done. And when I had that help, things got done faster. They got done better. And it just opened my eyes. So hired her. Eventually, when I took over the team, we hired another kind of contract manager assistant. Ended up hiring my best friend from college who was in the corporate world and hated his life. And he became my team manager. He got his real estate license. And from there, we hired a couple more agents who were helping us sell houses and make money on that front. And hired one of my cousins to do accounting work and bookkeeping. And then, yeah, we've always had a number of contractors we've worked with to fix the houses. Right now, I think we have five different kind of contracting crews who are working on different projects. And in the last year, I've hired three full-time employees who do the manual labor, swinging the hammer, work on my properties as well. So that's just been awesome having those guys where I know exactly what they're doing. I can tell them what to do. It's way cheaper than hiring contractors and gives you so much more control. So yeah, right now my team's expanded and I love having as much help as I can. And it's just a matter of making sure that the hires you make sense for the money that they cost and that you're keeping track of expenses because those can balloon out of control as well when you have a big team.
Yeah, definitely so. Well, Mark, what are your future goals with everything? You've got a lot going on from your flipping business to your buy and holds to your agency. What's in your future and why are you doing what you're doing?
Yeah, I mean, like I said, I love cars. So I always have a list of cars I'd love to buy and they're very expensive. So I have to make some big goals for those. But yeah, I have for the next year, I've just been working on my goals. One of them is to make $100,000 a month in the flipping business, which I figure is selling about three every month. So that's one of my goals for this year. I want to add $5,000 in cash flow per month this year from rental properties, and buying this big project will secure about half of that. So that would be great. And then, you know, with my blog, InvestFourMore.com, I want to keep growing that. I've published, you know, six books. So I'm always looking for new books to write. That's another way I've added passive income, which is really nice. And then just making sure I'm staying in the moment is a big goal too, because it's really easy to always be thinking about the future, always planning and not enjoy life and not take advantage of, you know, how fortunate I've been with everything going on.
Yeah, awesome. Yeah, well, it's really important to have those important whys and those things to strive for. Mark, it really keeps you going in this business, and that's something you have to have. So great stuff. All right, Mark, well, as we're wrapping up here, we've got a lightning round, just a series of questions we'd like to fire at you, and you just answer from the hip. You ready?
All right, we'll see how I do.
Okay, here we go. Well, Mark, what was your biggest hurdle getting started investing in real estate, and how did you overcome it?
I would go with the rental properties. I knew I wanted to buy rentals probably 2 years before I bought my first one. So even being in the business, even having flipped houses before, it took me a really long time to make that jump. And a lot of it was mindset, just getting in my head that, you know, if I buy below market value with cash flow, it's going to be a good investment. Don't be scared. And the money too. I was putting 20% down. So it takes time to save up that money, to get that money. And one way I bought my first rental was refinancing my personal house. So I used that money to buy the rental and then, you know, saving money as much as I could, refinancing some other rentals that did well and just kind of ballooning from there. So really finding the money and overcoming the fear of that first investment was the biggest thing.
Yeah, right. It's a common hurdle for lots of people getting started is just coming up with that first down payment. And then, you know, it eventually snowballs and snowballs and, you know, people grow into larger portfolios. So,
yep, exactly.
Well, Mark, do you have a personal habit that contributes to your success?
Yeah. Another thing that really helped me change my attitude to success was just, like I said, you know, started listening to self-help books, CDs, all that. Setting goals was probably the number one thing that helped me. Not being afraid to set big goals and keeping track of those goals. So, I mean, everyone wants to set, well, not everyone, but most people want to set goals. They set up the start of the year, they have their resolutions, but they forget about them a month later. So I always try and take time every night to kind of have my own personal time, review my day, look at my goals, and just remind myself what I'm going for, what the big picture is. Because it's so easy to get stuck in the day-to-day work in business and not look at what you're really trying to do. So I would say the one thing that helps me the most is just taking the time to look at the big picture, review my goals, and make sure I'm on track for the big items.
Right. Awesome. Okay, great. Well, Mark, do you have an online resource you find valuable?
There's a ton of them. I won't promote myself, but Bigger Pockets is a great resource. You know, I used to write for them. That's kind of where I first started in the online world. Some other resources that may not be as known to people, one I really like is investability.com, where it's kind of like Zillow, but they have rental property yields and cash flows and numbers for properties for sale across the country. So that's a really cool site I've used to find different markets to invest in. So when I was looking for out-of-state properties, I'd go on there, look at markets, see what rent-to-value ratios were, see what property taxes were. That was a really cool site that a lot of people might not know about.
Yeah, okay. That's investability.com. We'll link that in the show notes. All right, Mark, what book would you recommend to the listeners and why?
There's a lot of books that I really love. The One Thing by Gary Keller is an awesome book just about focusing on the most important things you can do, not getting too scatterbrained, because that's easy to do when you have a lot going on. Just thinking about to yourself, hey, what's the one thing I can do right now that would make the most difference in my business or my life instead of getting stuck doing busy work? So that's a really good book. And Stephen Pressfield's book, The War of Art, is just an amazing book too that really helped me get over mental blocks. And I have a little slogan in my home office that says, conquer the resistance. And just a quote to try and help you at the very end when you're close to finishing a project, there's always something that pops up, kind of slows you down, doesn't let you finish. And if you just recognize that as resistance and tell yourself, oh, hey, I ran into that resistance, I need to push through, it makes it so much easier to finish projects. So I love that book and that quote.
Awesome. Yeah. Well, that's The One Thing by Gary Keller and The War of Art by Stephen Pressfield. We'll link those books in the show notes. All right, Mark, last question. If you were to give advice to your 20-year-old self to get started investing in real estate, what would it be?
It would be buy houses.
Buy houses,
Yes. And get a good deal when you buy them too. Because I bought my first house when I was 22, which was great, but it was pretty much full retail. I looked at the numbers the other day. I think I spent probably $15,000 or $20,000 fixing it up, sold it 7 years later, and sold it for $10,000 less than I bought it for. So my timing wasn't great in the market, but at the same time, if I would have taken my time to get a really good deal, I would have been so much better off. So as an owner-occupant, there's so many good loans and advantages with the tax laws. Hopefully those don't change too much. But if you can get a really good deal on a house, live there a couple years, rent it out, and just kind of start building your portfolio as soon as you can, the time value of real estate is just amazing. So the sooner you can start buying houses, the better off you'll be.
Yeah, definitely so. All right, Mark, well, as we're wrapping up here, is there any parting piece of advice you'd like to leave with our audience?
I would just say focus. One of the biggest things I have people ask me is, how do you run a real estate team and flip houses and write for a blog and have rental properties without going crazy? And I tell them I didn't do all of it at once. I kind of started with one piece at a time, brought on people to help with those pieces, got them running well, and then I moved on to something else. So if you're going to try and get into real estate investing, don't try and flip houses and be a wholesaler and buy rentals and be an agent all at the same time.
Yay.
Focus on one thing, get really good at it, and you'll be so much better off than trying to do everything at once. People want to work with someone who's really good at what they want help with. They don't want someone who's kind of sort of good at 30 different things.
Yeah, definitely so. Well, Mark, you're no stranger yourself to helping people get started in this game. In fact, you've written a handful of books to help people get started, and you have your website, InvestFourMore. So can you tell us a little bit about where to find you and where to find those books at?
Yeah, no, InvestFourMore.com is the best place to find me. It's invest, and then the number four spelled out F-O-U-R and M-O-R-E.com. I've got something like 450 articles on there. I've got a podcast as well, YouTube channel you can find me on where we do before and after videos of all my flips, so you can see those. And then, the books, I've got six paperback books now, a couple audiobooks all on Amazon. So if you just search for Mark Ferguson on Amazon, those will pull up. And if people want to email me, it's just mark@investformore.com. I'm happy to have feedback and answer questions and help as much as I can.
All right, Mark. Well, thanks so much for coming on the show today. We really appreciate your time.
Oh, thank you for having me. Had a lot of fun and hopefully helped out a few people.
Thanks so much, Mark. Bye. All right. That wraps up our interview today with Mark Ferguson. Mark is a fascinating guy and cares so much about teaching others how they too can build passive income from real estate investing. Mark provides tons of great articles, videos, and different resources on his website at investformore.com and his YouTube channel, both of which are linked in the show notes. I hope you're getting value from the show, and I especially hope you liked today's episode. If so, let me know what you think. Drop me a rating and review on whichever platform you're listening on. I'd like to give some more upcoming shoutouts to those people who have left ratings and reviews. As always, if you have any questions or comments or want to hear something or someone specific on the show, reach out to me. You can contact me at www.jacobayers.com/contact or connect with me on Facebook at The Real Estate Way to Wealth and Freedom. Till next week, signing off, I'm your host, Jacob Ayers.
You've been listening to the Real Estate Way to Wealth and Freedom podcast, providing you actionable content to build your real estate empire. Nothing on this show should be considered specific, personal, or professional advice. Please consult an appropriate tax, legal, real estate, financial, or business professional for personal advice. The opinions of guests are their own. Information is not guaranteed. All investment strategies have a potential for profit or loss. The host is operating on behalf of the Real Estate Way to Wealth and Freedom, LLC, exclusively.